Keep watching to the end of this video for a special Astrum announcement. When you think of the space race, you probably imagine the tense Cold War era battle between the US and the Soviet Union. But what if I told you there was another player in the game? While the superpowers wrestled for space dominance, a small and newly independent nation started developing its own ambitions of reaching the stars and beating the big dogs to it. The story of Zambia's space program is a great example of humanity's overpowering curiosity to explore and understand the cosmos, no matter where we're from, and how far we're willing to go to do so. It's also a reminder that history is shaped by those who get to tell it, and it isn't only the loudest voices that leave the biggest legacies. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join me today as we dive into the little-known story of the Zambian space program, their proposed mission, unconventional training practices, and the lasting impact of their leader's vision. After World War II, the US and the Soviet Union realized that in a world with nuclear weapons, there can only be one superpower. They entered a bitter struggle for dominance, each racing to stay one step ahead of the other, engineering increasingly powerful rocketry and weapons technology. It didn't take long for their arms race to become a space race. By the early 1960s, new milestones in space exploration were being made every year. Both programs had unwavering political and public support, which meant lots of funding, press, and progress. All eyes were on them, and the stakes were super high. Half a world away, Edward Mukuka Unkoloso was watching too. A passionate science school teacher, he dreamed of one day creating his own Zambian space program to rival those of the Americans and Soviets. The only problem? His country was facing its own political struggle, the struggle for independence. Zambia, then called Northern Rhodesia, had been under British colonial rule since 1888. Through the 1950s, Zambians grew increasingly disillusioned with colonialist policies such as racial discrimination and limited political representation for Africans. Nkoloso was one of these Africans. After fighting in World War II on behalf of Britain, he opened a school for Zambians, which was promptly shut down by the British authorities. This pushed him to join the Zambian Resistance Movement and later the United National Independence Party. Nkoloso also worked hard for both causes close to his heart. While one hand was fighting for Zambian independence, the other was building the Zambia National Academy of Science, Space Research and Philosophy, which opened in 1960. The details of what went down at his academy are murky, but it seems this is where Nkoloso's idea for a Zambian space mission emerged. He was going to send Zambian astronauts, or Afronauts, as he called them, to the moon and then to Mars, and he was going to do it before the US or the Soviet Union. We have been studying the planet through telescopes at our headquarters and are now certain Mars is populated by primitive natives, he says. Specially trained space girl Marta Mwambwa, two cats, also specially trained, and a missionary will be launched in our first rocket. But I have warned the missionary he must not force Christianity on the people of Mars if they do not want it. If you're wondering about the cats, they were thrown in partly for companionship for Marta, partly as a survival testing device. Marta was to throw one out onto the Martian surface on arrival, and if it survived, she'd know it was safe for her to emerge too. In 1964, Nkoloso announced his mission was ready. The first rocket was planned to launch on Zambia's Independence Day, October 24th, 1964. Now, going up into space is never an easy task. You've got to be in tip-top physical and mental shape to be an astronaut. In the early days of the space age, some training exercises were grueling or even downright dangerous. In the 1960s, cosmonauts were undergoing all kinds of rigorous physical training and conditioning. For instance, they were put in a centrifuge, to recreate the intense G-forces of launch, which is incredibly dangerous as it puts a lot of strain on your heart and lungs. Such training could lead to oxygen starvation and cause trainees to pass out. It also limits the ability of your heart to pump blood upwards against gravity to your brain and other vital organs. Long-term exposure to multiple G-forces can lead to complications like arrhythmias over time. Cosmonauts also underwent parabolic flights for weightlessness training, named for the parabolic flight path the aircraft follows. At the top of the curve, the acceleration of the aircraft cancels out the acceleration due to gravity, achieving a feeling of momentary weightlessness for the passengers. It's kind of like when you're on a swing, and at the highest point of your swing, you feel weightless for just a moment. Except in an aircraft with the right trajectory, you can feel that microgravity for up to 40 seconds. While effective, these flights were risky due to the high potential for mechanical failure or pilot error, as only the most skilled pilots at the time could pull off the precise maneuvers needed. Cosmonauts also had to be prepared to confront an incredibly harsh environment in the event their mission might land far from recovery zones. Wilderness survival training in Siberia was an essential part of mission training, which sounds absolutely brutal. Even in modern times, the lengths some will go through to reach out for space can be quite perilous. Daredevil Mike Hughes discovered that after constructing his own homemade rocket in an attempt to prove his belief that the Earth is flat. In February 2020, his rocket tragically malfunctioned during a test flight, killing him instantly. While no one died in the Zambia space program, its training definitely raised some eyebrows. Nkulosso designed a series of mental and physical tests to prepare his astronauts for space travel. One such exercise was teaching his recruits to walk on their hands, claiming that this was the only way people can walk on the moon. It's unclear where that idea came from, since he was an educated man and was presumably following the latest space race updates closely. To simulate zero gravity, he'd put his recruits in an oil barrel one by one and roll them down a hill, bouncing them over rough ground to simulate turbulence. When they hit a particularly big bump, he celebrated, claiming they just experienced anti-gravity conditions, an exercise which is obviously uncomfortable, potentially dangerous, and definitely not scientifically sound. Another approach they took to weightlessness training actually involved something I mentioned earlier. They tied two ropes into a swing and would swing on it, getting higher and higher. At the time they least expected it, another trainee would cut the rope so they could experience the free fall to the ground. Not a much better approach. And the rocket ship they were training for? It was a 10-foot oil barrel with an air hole in it, made of space-grade aluminium and copper. Care to know how they were initially planning to launch it? With a catapult. His willing recruits were a group of 12 teenagers he was training at the Space Program's HQ, a secret location 7 miles outside of Lusaka, at an abandoned farmhouse. Marta Mwambwa, the girl who was supposed to actually fly the mission, was just 16 years old at the time. NASA had ex-military Air Force pilots and engineers in state-of-the-art, purpose-built facilities. Nkulosso had a dozen high school children in a field. Now, I know it seems like I'm making this up, but this really happened, as absurd as it all sounds. And that's what's so mysterious about Nkulosso. He was an intelligent guy. He read about space. He was a science teacher, a veteran, and a valued member of the political movement that led to the nation's independence. So, what was his end game? Why was he talking about this mission if he must have known it wasn't viable? Some have speculated that his motivation to join the space race came from a place of national pride and a desire to elevate not just Zambia, but all of Africa to the world stage. He was seen as working to dismantle stereotypes about Africans that had held steady during the colonial era, and instead show that Africans are capable of contributing to scientific and technological advancements. If his goal was to get the international press talking, he certainly succeeded. Time magazine ran an article about him, as did several other outlets. News crews went out to film video interviews with him and record his team training. His colorful personality and outlandish claims definitely helped capture public imagination and media curiosity, even if it wasn't clear if he was serious or not. Uncle also maintained he was serious until his death in 1989. When asked about it in 2016, the first president of Zambia, Kenneth Kaunda, said, "It wasn't a real thing. It was more for fun than anything else." There's another theory that his whole project was satire, a parody of the Western conquest of other nations. There didn't seem to be a reason for such goofy-looking training exercises other than to capture people's attention. Even during his interviews, he always stayed in character with his standard issue helmet and flowing cape, but he'd throw in subtle jibes at the world powers, calling them imperialist neo-colonialists who were scared of Zambia's space knowledge. Remember the Christian missionary he wanted to send to Mars with the girl and the cats? He had explicitly warned the missionary he must not force Christianity on the people of Mars if they do not want it, a luxury many colonizing nations did not afford their conquered lands. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Nkoloso's project never received public or political support. He had written to UNESCO asking for a £7 million grant to make his mission a reality, a drop in the bucket compared to NASA's $25.4 billion Apollo funding. It's also been reported he asked for $1.9 billion from private foreign sources, but the Ministry of Power, Transport and Communication was quick to clarify this request was not made on behalf of the government. In the end, the only funding he got was 10 rupees from a young Indian boy. Most Zambians did not resonate with the space program and didn't feel it accurately represented the feelings of the nation. In fact, his own Afronauts deserted him. Two recruits reportedly went out drinking one night and were never seen again. Another left to join a traveling song and dance group. Amata ended up having a child of her own and staying home instead of going to Mars. In hindsight, we can only speculate what Nkoloso's true intentions might have been. Maybe it was a ruse to make international headlines and get the name of a newly independent country out there. Given Nkoloso's history as a revolutionary, it wouldn't be out of character for him to want to replace the name Northern Rhodesia with Zambia on the world stage. And while he had everyone's attention, he might have thrown in some satire aimed at the superpowers just for fun. Or he might have hoped, against all odds, that their hard work and determination would impress the right people and actually get Zambians into space. Or perhaps he was simply trying to make some kids feel like they were part of something big and important. What we do know is that he never let setbacks squander his determination and belief in his vision. Thanks to him, even for a brief moment, Zambia entered the space race against the US and the Soviets. This is a vibrant story of one man's audacity, determination, and self-belief. The reality is that not everyone who dreams of making it into space ends up going there. But whether he meant to or not, Nkoloso told the world, "We are here, we are Zambian, and we are free." In a way, he reminded us that those epic, larger-than-life endeavors like reaching for the stars and exploring the vastness of the universe stem from a desire innate in us all. And that in itself makes it a story worth telling. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, you might like my others about space history. Have you heard of the Apollo 15 postal scandal that landed three revered astronauts in a congressional hearing? Click here to watch it next. Here's a little behind the scenes for you. There's an entire team of people here at Astrum that work full time to create these videos about a passion that unites us, space. Our work is possible thanks to all of you on Patreon. So to say thank you, we're giving away these lovely Astrum pins to all you members. If you would like to support the work we do here and get one of these pins, we've extended the giveaway to the end of the month. I'll order them in the next few days and they should be shipped out to you early next year. Stay tuned on the Patreon updates, and as always, thank you. Thanks for watching. I really want to give a huge thank you to our astronauts on Patreon. It's really becoming a thriving community, and I've loved reading all your messages and comments over there. If you'd like to join in, then you can visit the link in the description to become an astronaut and bring the channel more stability than the algorithm. When you join, you'll be able to watch the whole video ad-free, see your name in the credits, and submit questions to our team. Once again, a huge thank you from myself and the whole Astrum team. Meanwhile, click the link to this playlist for more Astrum content. I'll see you next time.